I'm not here to talk about the past. I'm here to talk about the positive and not the negative about this issue. I would say that steroids are wrong. Do not take them. It gives you nothing but false hope.
A little less than 5 years later, the entire tone has changed from what Mark McGwire said. While many of us suspected for years that there is some performance-enhancing use today, he confirmed that. John Kruk is here. I'm Carl Ravitch. Welcome to our Baseball Tonight special. We'll take you to 11 o'clock in the East. And over the course of the next 90 minutes, we'll be joined by the likes of, we'll hear from Tony La Russa, Hall of Famer Joe Morgan, Rick Sutcliffe, T.J. Quinn, Gary Wadler, who, of course, is the director of the World Anti-Doping Agency. We'll also get the thoughts of Buster Olney and Tim Kirkchin. The news began to come out right around 3 o'clock Eastern Standard Time when McGwire released a statement to the Associated Press. In that, he admitted to using steroids for nearly a decade, including during the 1998 season, in which he blasted what was then a record 70 home runs. Eighth on the all-time home run list, Mark McGwire is responsible for numerous indelible images, of course, throughout his career, and certainly during that 1998 Summer of Love that he shared with Sammy Sosa. Before we hear from our experts, we get a chance to hear from Mark McGwire, who conducted an interview with Bob Costas on the MLB Network. It lasted roughly 1 hour. Here are some of the highlights from that interview.
I wish it never came into my life, but we're sitting here talking about it. I'm so sorry that I have to. And I apologize to everybody in Major League Baseball. My family, the Marises, Bud Selig. Today was the hardest day of my life. I told my dad yesterday when I finally had to tell him about this. I remember calling him in 96. I was so frustrated with injuries, I wanted to retire. So he's the one that told me to stick it out. And at that time I was using steroids thinking it was gonna help me and help me. It was brought to my attention that it was gonna help me heal faster, make my body feel back to normal. So 2005, it's meaning to go back to testify. Flying back there, I was ready, willing, and prepared to talk about this. I wanted to talk about this. I wanted to get this off my chest. So here I am in a situation where I have two scenarios where a possible prosecution or possible grand jury testimonies. Well, you know what happens when there's a prosecution? You bring in your whole family. You bring in your whole friends. You bring in ex-teammates, coaches, anybody that's around you. How the heck am I going to bring those people in for some stupid act that I did? So you know what I did? We agreed to not talk about the past. And it was not enjoyable to do that, Bob. I'm going to tell you right now, standing up there or sitting up there, listening with the Hooten family and the other families that were behind me that lost their loved ones, mm-hmm. And every time that I kept on saying, I'm not talking about the past, I hear these moans. It was killing me. It was absolutely killing my heart. But I had to do what I had to do to protect myself, to protect my family, and to protect my friends. All I want to do is come clean. I've been wanting to come clean ever since 2005. And, you know, I didn't know where or when or how. Just been holding this in.
How much of a burden was it to carry this secret, even in the if in the minds of some it was an open secret, to carry this secret until today?
I think you see it.
We'll have much more of the Mark McGwire interview coming up, including some of the references that he did or did not make to the effects that the performance-enhancing drugs may have had on him. But at first blush, if you watched those 3 minutes, you're left with the impression that someone wanted to acknowledge that he used steroids, and he accomplished that, right?
Well, that's exactly right, Carl. And what if we've asked about this so-called steroid era in baseball? Just admit it. The guys who have admitted, Jason Giambi, guys like Andy Pettit, not so much steroids, but human growth hormone, they've basically been given a pass. Alex Rodriguez has even had a sort of a reprieve of everything that's gone on in his career because of his admission to using steroids. So, you know, we asked them to do that. Now, Mark McGwire's done it. He did it in a kind of unusual way. The fact that, you know, he didn't think they helped his performance on the field, even though they're called performance-enhancing drugs. But we got an admission from one of the biggest guys in the steroid era. He admitted that he used steroids. That's what we're here for.
All right. Yeah, we all know the term PEDs, performance-enhancing drugs. Let's bring Buster Olney in now. And he seemed to change it to HEDs, which were health-enhancing drugs. No question he makes the distinction that these allowed him to be healthy. What he didn't really make the connection to was being healthy allowed him to play the game, which allowed his home run totals to rise.
That's exactly right. Now, overall, I think McGwire, during his interview with Bob Costas, people saw the real remorse in him, the fact that he is disappointed, that he disappointed other people. When he tells the story about calling Roger Maris's widow and telling her about this and saying that her reaction was disappointment, and Mark said she has the right to feel that way. But what he said about the impact of performance-enhancing drugs on him made no sense whatsoever. On one hand, he talked specifically about how performance-enhancing drugs, he used them because he wanted to get healthy, to deal with the grind of a 162-game season. Well, if he's on the field more, that means he's going to hit more home runs. That means he's going to put up totals that we haven't seen before. That's certainly not an advantage that Hank Aaron had, or Willie Mays, or Babe Ruth. And I can tell you right now, I've reached out in the last hour to some former players. There's some guys who are really upset because the feeling is, okay, you did that. You acknowledged out loud what we always thought that you did. But come on. I mean, that was, in the eyes of other ex-players, that was an advantage that he had that other players chose not to have.
Of course, this was the player of the year in college baseball, and his career started out with 49 home runs when he came to the major leagues. Tim Kirkshen now joins us. We'll get to the Hall of Fame stuff over the course of the next 90 minutes, Tim. But at first blush, what was your reaction to the things that he said or did not say in this interview?
Well, I spoke to him about 2 hours before that interview, and he said many of the same things to me, and he was extremely emotional, even over the phone. I thought he was genuine, and I thought he was sincere in his apology and everything else. And yet, I was left with a couple of major questions. Number one, he told me over and over again, I really wanted to talk that day in Congress, and yet it took him 5 more years to come out and speak to anyone, which really kind of struck me as a little bit odd. And then, as Buster said and others have said, when he said it didn't help my performance at all, steroids were just an illusion, as he told me and others, then why did he take them? And why is he even apologizing? If he didn't do anything that really helped his performance, then why is he so regretful for what he did? That's what left me as a little confused. But I can tell you, Ravi, having spoken to him on the phone, this was different than Congress. He was much more emotional. He gave us much more than he gave us 5 years ago. It may not be what everyone wanted, obviously. Alex Rodriguez didn't give us everything that we wanted when he spoke to us also. But this was better than what he did in Congress. There's no way around that.
All right, Timmy, thank you. More from Tim in a second. Let me ask you this, Crocky. Is it possible that this clear disappointment comes not from the fact that he used steroids because he believes he used them for a health reason, but the disappointment comes from sort of the collateral damage, the inability in his own mind to tell the truth to his own family, to the Maris family. He dragged other people into this. Is that where the sort of sadness, contrition comes from, not from the steroid use?
Yeah, I think that's what it is. I, Mark McGwire, I talked to people who play with him in Oakland, and the thing about Mark was he wanted to please everyone. He wanted to be a great teammate. He wanted everyone on the team to like him. He wanted the coaching staff, the managers, the front office, the fans, everyone to like him. So yeah, that's what's the difficult thing to him, I would imagine, was to go and express shame to people that he felt like he let a lot of people down in this. But I have a hard time understanding that no one in his family or no one in his inner circle of friends or whoever ever once asked him, night out with the boys, hey, did you or didn't you? As he said, no one ever asked him, and he never told anyone. So that's It's kind of a tough one.
Yeah, part of the interview, he did say that these last 24 to 48 hours were the first time that he told anybody, including his own family, including the manager of the St. Louis Cardinals, Tony La Russa, including the commissioner of Major League Baseball, and the St. Louis Cardinals, who a couple of months ago decided, hey, we'd like you to be our hitting instructor, and apparently, by his own admission, said to them at that point, okay, I appreciate that, but we're going to need to get this story out. So it seems like if we have to get a story out, there was certainly a reference to, well, the team now knows that there's something I got to say.
Yeah, that's the whole confusing thing about this, because, you know, Mark said that no one, he told me this on the phone, no one knew, I didn't tell anyone, I kept it all to myself, absolutely no one knew. Teammate, manager, coaches, trainer, no one knew what I was doing. I was doing it on my own. Well, if that's the case, then how come, you know, what he said in that interview was he went to Congress and his lawyers went to Congressman Davis and said, hey, we want immunity because I want to talk. Well, you know, that someone knows. You know, that's the confusing thing about this whole thing is that, you know, I think more people knew than what is being led on to believe.
Interesting behind the scenes stories of what happened back in March of 05, coming up shortly from TJ Quinn, who was there on Capitol Hill. One of the things McGwire also said was he wished that he never played in the steroid era. He also suggested he wished that there was drug testing, that he wouldn't have been in this situation. But if you look at the top 10 current home run hitters since 1985, seven of them have been at least linked or reportedly used the PEDs. I mentioned the fact that Tony La Russa was the first to invite McGwire to be his hitting instructor. Earlier today on Baseball Tonight, I had a chance to talk with the Cardinal manager.
Well, I knew that, you know, he had decided that, you know, before he could, you know, officially start doing the hitting coach job, that he would be forthcoming. Didn't know till this morning. He called me this morning, and we talked for a while. And as first I heard, you know, since then I've read the statement, so I know what he said, and he's given me some other, you know, explanations. So I'm really encouraged that he would step forward, and I think as we go along, his explanations, I think will be well received.
When you talked to him about this hitting coach's job, was that one of the things you discussed, having this sort of come to the public with this?
Well, the whole idea, I mean, since he left in 2001, you know, he retired because his back was just betraying him. Mm-hmm. An important part of the story is as his development as a hitter, you know, when he first started from 87, and I think the injuries in the 93, 94, when he missed so many games, he really watched TV and, you know, sit in the clubhouse and started really understanding the game between the pitcher and the hitter, and then he really became smart about the stroke. And so I watched that development, and at the end, you know, he was really as smart as was anybody out there about making adjustments, and he understood totally what the stroke was like and how to work on it. So just like, you know, like Albert's doing now, for example. So when he quit, I've always encouraged him. I mean, it's well said, known that, you know, I've encouraged him to come to spring training as a guest instructor just to pass this along. So when I called him, it was about, you know, about the hitting coach's position, and he was receptive to talk about it. As we got serious about it, you know, then we discussed that, you know, there's no way that we could have a distraction in spring training, because, you know, there's time to work, and then, you know, and the people, you know, they wanted to hear from Mark. So, he, you know, it's just a matter of timing.
Now, my own perception, and listening to the things you've said in the past, were that you would be surprised about some revelations like this. What was your reaction to this?
No, I have been very careful in what I said. I knew that the programs we ran, the official program we ran at the ballpark in Oakland and St. Louis, were 100% legit, and the strength gains and the edges that we developed were entirely, you know, legit and the product of hard work. Mm-hmm. I also knew that nobody was a better example of that than Mark. I watched him religiously work over the years, continue to work. I mean, he works till today. He looks great. So, but I know that, you know, I became aware of what's happening during the times and, you know, the competitive edge that everybody was trying to go for. And I also knew, because we had examples, the most recent that I can think of was Rick Ankiel there at the end of his pitching career when he had his second elbow operation, that there was a, you know, a strong body of opinion that, your rehab could be either saved or improved by of an injury. Mm-hmm. And I know that Mark was really devastated with, you know, for several years there with a succession of injuries to where we all with the AIDS wonder whether he would ever be able to have a career.
So correct me if I'm wrong. So you knew then that there were steroids and HGH being used, or you did not? I don't want to put words
in
your
mouth. I didn't know anything except that I knew that we ran a legit program and that Mark was a good example of working his butt off and getting all his strength gains, you know, because of the product of hard work. And I also did and still speak to his character and integrity. Mm-hmm. But over the years, I've learned that, you know, there are guys with injuries, for example, that, you know, I mean, you had prescribed HGH, for example. So I didn't know anything. I mean, Mark and I never confronted it, and he never told me till this morning.
Until this morning. And now it doesn't change your opinion at all about him as a hitting instructor or perhaps the credibility with which he'll speak because of his work ethic that you talked about?
No, I actually think that as the entire circumstances come out of you know, his usage, why, when, where, I think that it would be, I think he'll come off and regain a lot of the stature that he had with fans and with his peers about, you know, being a solid pro and you know, where he made mistakes. So, you know, I read the statement. He admits that he made mistakes and he's sorry for it. I feel like we all make mistakes and at least he owns up to it. I'll tell you one thing, you know, he got so much criticism about his performance in Congress. The one thing he did not do was lie, and I don't think he ever would.
All right, we'll have much more with Tony's good friend Bobby Knight, and much more on Mark McGwire, who's a friend to both of these guys, as we continue here on Baseball Tonight. So going back to 2005, and perhaps with the suggestion for Major League Baseball that Mark go do this, today the commissioner, Bud Selig, had this to say: I am pleased that Mark McGwire has confronted his use of performance-enhancing substances as a player. Being truthful is always the correct course of action, which is why I had commissioned Senator George Mitchell to conduct his investigation. This statement of contrition, I believe, will make Mark's re-entry into the game much smoother and easier. When we come back, we'll be joined by the director of the World Anti-Doping Agency. McGwire suggests, in his mind, this didn't help him perform at all. Will that be disputed on Baseball Tonight, right after this?
Axel winds and fires. Big Mac, swing, and a shot into the corner. It might make it. There it is, 62, folks. It just got over the left field wall in the corner. And we have a new home run champion.
Hugging the Maris family, lifting his own son over his head, again, some of the indelible images that McGwire provided us throughout his career, and in particular during that record-setting 1998 season. And then subsequently, 3 years later, Barry Bonds eclipsed that 70 home run mark by blasting 73. Sammy Sosa in 98, of course, with McGwire, took that down to the wire as they were battling for the home run single season crown. 66 for Sosa and those 70 for Mark McGwire. Well, earlier tonight we had a chance to listen into some of the excerpts that McGwire provided to Bob Costas. We didn't get too deep into the effects that the performance-enhancing drugs had on McGwire, at least in his own mind. Before we get to Gary Wardle, the chairman of the World Anti-Doping Agency, let's get a listen to what McGwire had to say to Costas about the PEDs and their impact on his performance.
The only reason that I took steroids was for my health purposes. I did not take steroids to get any gain for any strength purposes.
But did you get that gain incidentally?
For my health purposes, to make my body feel
normal. Did you
normal.
Become stronger? In addition to helping you battle injuries and stay healthy, didn't you become stronger? Didn't you get greater bat speed? Didn't you become not just extraordinary power hitter?
I've always had bat speed. I just learned how to shorten my bat speed. I learned how to be a better hitter. There's not a pill or an injection that is going to give me the hand-eye or give any athlete a hand-eye coordination to hit a baseball.
What you're sitting here telling me is that you could have done essentially what you did without ever touching performance-enhancing drugs. That's your belief.
And that's why it's the most regrettable thing I've ever done in my life.
All right, time now to bring in Gary Wadler, the chairman of the World Anti-Doping Agency, to comment on some of the things that McGwire said there. Gary, certainly the implication from Mark in his mind is he believes that with or without these steroids, and in this case, without them, he would have been able to, if healthy, put up the same numbers he did using performance-enhancing drugs. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I have a little doubt about that. I mean, there's no question that anabolic steroids, given the certain adequate dosage, will do things to performance which have nothing to do with your mindset. I mean, it makes your muscles bigger and faster, more acceleration, greater strength. And so the mechanics of hitting a baseball, you know, if you're hitting a ball with greater acceleration or more force, the ball's going to go further, no matter what you think. So he may have said, I'm taking it to get rehab. A, he should have declared it. And B, I suspect whether he liked it or not, his performance was influenced by the fact that he was taking these things. Now, Mark McGwire should have come forth way back. Why now, I guess, is as good a question as any, whether it's relating to his opportunity to coach or whether he feels remorse as another Hall of Fame season has gone by and he's not in that. I'm not sure what's behind it, but it seems to me he's still talking around it somewhat, and I think Bob Costas put his finger on it pretty well. I mean, there's no question that his performance, if he was in fact taking steroids, was going to be enhanced, and the numbers seem to bear that out.
Well, he was in fact taking them by his own admission. What he did say, and perhaps you could shed some light on this, he makes the distinction between using low dosages. He also wouldn't necessarily recollect what steroids he used, and we'll ask TJ Quinn about that. But when someone says low dosages and was asked about HGH and he says once, maybe twice, from your perspective, what is a low dose? What does that really mean to the layman?
Well, what does it mean to anybody? I'm actually testifying all week as an expert in a federal steroid distribution trial for Applied Pharmacy Services. It's been on trial. And it's interesting to hear everybody's spin on what a low dosage is, what an appropriate dosage. There is no appropriate dose. It's an illegal use of the substance at that time. And so it just seems to me getting caught up in semantics. The fact of the matter is he now admits that he used anabolic steroids. It seems to me he should have admitted it up front for the congressional hearings and subsequent to those hearings. I think, as we know in this country, the American public is very forgiving when you go mea culpa. It was my fault. I erred. I made bad decisions. But this is 10 years later. This is a week or two later. Why 10 years later?
11 o'clock here in the East as we continue on this Baseball Tonight special to follow the revelations today from Mark McGwire, number 8 on the all-time home run list, that he used steroids for the course of a decade and also used a human growth hormone, in his words, once, maybe twice. We're currently talking to Gary Wadler, the chairman of WADA, which is the World Anti-Doping Agency. For people who listen to Mark say, and I really believe that he believes he was doing this so that his body would feel normal, what does that mean to you? I want my body to feel normal so I can go out and play.
Well, let's face it. The game of baseball, as all our sports, are dictated by rules. The rules, which are much clearer now than before when this was going on. And to be fair, Mark McGwire was using Andro at a time when Andro was legal in baseball. Andro was legal in the United States. It was Mark McGwire's experience and change in federal laws as they relate to steroids. The rules of the game are totally different now. So it's hard to. I'm not trying to be judgmental. I think what the issue is, the reality is, his record was impacted by the use of steroids. It's very hard to understand what his performance would have been had he not been on steroids. It'll be a subject of conjecture forever. Nobody will ever know. And nobody can know, and that's sort of the problem.
But unequivocally, in your opinion, his performance was improved, was enhanced by the use of the steroids.
Well, if he took a single dose of steroids, it's not going to enhance performance. So he had to be on some reasonable dose for some period of time. I do think it'd be useful if he came forward and was explicit about the nature of the steroids, where he got them, what was the names of them, how much did he take, I think we can fill in a lot of the blanks if he was totally candid and say, here's the facts as they existed. I made a mistake, yes, and here's what I specifically did. These are the steroids that I took. Believe me, the people who use steroids know which ones they take. Here's how long I took them for. Did I cycle them? Did I stack them? Did I use them in combination with human growth hormone? What did I do should be what he should be saying. Here's what I have done. Now, forgive me. But right now he's saying, well, I took it for the rehab. I took small amounts. It probably didn't impact my performance. There's no question that it's not going to give you eye-hand coordination. Either you're an athlete or you're not, whether you're a hitter or not, we're talking about percentage points increasing his output. And that is not making him a baseball player or making him a hitter. It's just moving him up a notch in terms of his performance.
Gary Wadler, the MD and the chairman of the WADA, World Anti-Doping Agency, thank you very much. We appreciate you joining us here on Baseball Tonight.
My pleasure.
Well, I've gotten a lot of strange looks from you today, but clearly when I said it's 11 o'clock and it's only 10 o'clock, you gave me a real strange look because you were thinking that perhaps this hour was actually over, but you still have one more hour. Based on what McGwire said and what you heard from him, I know that you were frustrated in this sort of disconnect that McGwire was kind of pointing out, or the connect that he was unwilling to do between taking these and hitting home runs.
Well, there's a direct connection. You know, look, Mark McGwire would have been a great home run hitter if he didn't take steroids, because if you saw him play in the minor leagues, you know, you saw him play his rookie season when he hit 49 home runs, you knew the swing was there, the body was there to hit home runs. Tall, lanky, angular. You know, the steroids, though, to me, helped him hit home runs. Did it help him hit 70 in a season? Yes, it did. Would he have hit maybe 40 or 50, 55 in a season? I think he would have. But the bottom line is, to say that steroids aren't going to help you hit a baseball, it's true. You have to have the ability to hand-eye coordination to do it. A lot of guys in Major League Baseball, you have to have that hand-eye coordination to do it. Now, what I've been saying all along, though, when you take steroids, you add that strength along with the hand-eye coordination, the strength that you can't get naturally, that's why balls travel farther distances for a longer period of time. And that's the thing people don't understand. You can hit one or two home runs taking steroids farther than you've ever hit a baseball. But the bottom line is, you recover quicker. You're not sore the next day. You can go out and you're fresh more. You know, that's the thing with the 162-game season he keeps talking about. You know, I had to prepare myself for 162-game season. Everyone does. Everyone has to prepare for 162 days. The bottom line is, do you prepare with it by doing something, cheating the game, doing something illegally, so you can play 162 games? And because he did, he hit more home runs over a longer period of time than most normal people would have.
All right, let's bring Buster Olney back in here. I know that you said, Buster, that you spoke to several players, and they were, I think the term you used was either upset or angry. Clearly, this idea that your Crucky just raised has got him a little upset. Is that the type of reaction that players are giving, that, hey, everybody had to recover?
No question about it. If you want to talk about a tale of frustration, you could talk about Wally Joyner, who was one of Mark McGwire's peers. Came into the league in 1986, hit 22 homers in his first year, which at that time was pretty decent power numbers for a first baseman, 34 homers a second year. But then as he got older, his power numbers began to dissipate. As he gets into his early mid-30s, he starts to deal with injuries. He's looking around the landscape of baseball, and the guys who are his peers are suddenly hitting 65 homers, 70 homers in a season, and as he said to me a few years ago, he knew intuitively why that was. He didn't know exactly who was doing what, but he knew intuitively that players are using performance-enhancing drugs. He thought about taking it because he wanted to stay in baseball. He took two pills on two occasions, flushed the rest down the toilet because he couldn't live with himself. And I'm sure that a lot of players like Wally Joyner tonight, to hear McGwire talk about how it didn't affect his performance, a lot of frustration because a lot of other players didn't make the same choice that Mark McGwire made.
Hi, Buster. Thank you. Let's get Tim Kirkshen back in here. And clearly this steroid era, which McGwire wished he could distance himself from, there are so many who, like the Buster story there about Wally Joyner, Crucky here says he never used steroids. You wonder, would the field be closer? And I don't mean to take away from what McGwire was able to accomplish, but is the field, the massive number of players, is it much narrower? Is it closer?
Well, it's certainly fewer guys are using today. We have to agree with that. But Ravi, this is part of the problem. I've asked over the last 6 months, two guys who used to play in the big leagues and now are in the medical community and know a lot more about steroids than I do and than most of us do. I asked one of them, how many home runs do you think Barry Bonds hit with steroids? I'm just using Bonds, not McGwire, in this example. He said, oh, he hit at least 400 home runs because of steroids. Another guy I asked the same question, similar background, in the medical field now, he said he hit zero home runs because of steroids. And this is one of the really big problems that we have now is we have one guy saying 400, we have another guy saying zero, and yet it's really difficult to narrow it down. And that's the real problem here. Having said that, Krucky's right. When you get bigger and stronger, the ball is going to travel a little bit further. Logically, you have to see that. And Mark McGwire's performance did indeed get better because he was out on the field. That seems obvious to me. So to say it didn't help me at all, well, of course it did. It got you out on the field. Did it make your hands quicker? Maybe not. Maybe not. But it did get you out there, and you were bigger and stronger, and that has to help with an extra distance on a home run ball.
All right, and we'll ask Tim and Buster whether this helped or hurt McGwire's chances to get into the Hall of Fame, and if perhaps it helped clear up their thoughts on whether they would vote for him or continue to vote for him. Rick Sutcliffe is also going to join us, get his perspective on this. Joe Morgan a little bit later on as we continue on a Baseball Tonight special. Back here on our Baseball Tonight special, ESPN Sports Nation has been asked, now that he has admitted to using steroids, what is Mark McGwire's Hall of Fame fate? Will he be voted in by the Baseball Writers Association of America? 15% say yes. 17.8% say he'll be voted in by the Veterans Committee. And 67% of the public say he will never get in, which certainly suggests, similar to his vote total now, but perhaps even elevated, get, 30% of the vote, 25% of the vote. He got 23% of the vote this year. The thoughts of Tim Kirkchin and Buster only coming up in just a moment. Hall of Famer Joe Morgan, of course, our ESPN Sunday Night Baseball analyst, joins us now. Hall of Famer obviously has huge connotations. Mark McGwire's vote total has been around 23, 24. First of all, as a baseball player, what's your reaction to it, not the Hall of Fame part?
Well, I feel good for Mark if he feels good about doing it. It's up to Mark to decide, when to come out. He decided this was the time, and he went forward. Basically, we've been indicting him on his performance, at the hearings, congressional hearings. And that's all we've been indicting him on in the past. Now he's come forward and said he did it, and I think people have to look at that and decide for themselves. But the one thing I will say about Mark McGwire is that he never complained, about his total as far as the Hall of Fame. He never complained about, being put in that era. I guess the one thing that stands out more than anything else that he said for me was that he wished that he would not have played in the steroid era. And I agree with that. I think it's very difficult for guys to play in that era and stay clean. But saying that, my point is I cannot excuse the fact that the players use performance-enhancing drugs to enhance their numbers and to make more money. I mean, what about the players who didn't cheat? These guys were at a disadvantage. They didn't make as much money because their statistics weren't as high as the other guys. Yeah. And when it comes to the Hall of Fame, their statistics aren't going to compare to those guys, so they're going to get hit with a double whammy.
No doubt.
So about those guys, but what about the guys that didn't do it?
I understand. What would he have to complain about? When you said one thing he hasn't done is complain, what would he have to complain about knowing the truth? I mean, if only he knew the truth, what would he complain about?
Well, because the other people didn't know the truth. He could have complained that, like Tim said, that he's been voting for him.
But the other people did know the truth. Joe, even you said it. We've been indicting him. Now this kind of confirms what most people seem to have suspected.
Well, I agree with that, but I'm just saying that he could have complained that he only got 21% of the vote.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's a low total for anybody.
What's your take?
I don't believe that when the other guys who have been had performance-enhancing drugs tied to their name, when their names comes up, I don't think that they're going to get 21%.
What's your take on Mark McGwire as a baseball player, knowing what you know now? How much does it help, in your opinion?
Well, it's hard for me to put a percentage on it because I've watched all these players over the years. I started having my own suspicions when I saw guys taking low and away fastballs and hitting them over the right field wall when I had not seen that, in the past. Pitchers had no place to pitch. When they could stay away, they'd hit it home runs over the right field wall. It came inside, they pulled it. So I started having my suspicions. My problem is I don't know how you separate the guys who did and their numbers from the guys who didn't. That's the most difficult part for me, and I would think that would be the most difficult part for the baseball writers when they're judging guys for the Hall of Fame.
All right, Joe Morgan, the baseball analyst for ESPN, Sunday Night Games, as well as a Hall of Famer. Thanks for joining us, Joe.
All right. Tucker.
So the question really is going to be, what effect will this have? And you see that McGwire, since 2007, first year of eligibility, 23% of the vote. Will it go up? Will it go down? Will it stay the same? Let's get some thoughts of the guys that actually have a chance to vote. Tim Kirkshin, I know that you've said on this program before that you have historically voted for McGwire. Will today change that opinion?
I don't think so, Ravi. I mean, I'll look at it again, but as of now, I'm voting for all the guys in the steroid era, knowing that this is an era-wide issue. And I think Joe Morgan makes a good point, a point we've all tried to make, is we just don't have enough facts in the case here. Exactly who did, exactly what, and how much it enhanced their performance. And in the absence of the facts, in trying to be fair, I'm going to vote for Mark McGwire as I have all of these years. The problem is, Mark McGwire is not getting in the Hall of Fame anytime soon. I would be shocked if he got in on his 15 years on the ballot. And I promise you, the way things are going, when Barry Bonds, Alex Rodriguez, Manny Ramirez, Roger Clemens, anyone with a connection to steroids comes up for the Hall of Fame, they are certainly not getting in their first year. And they're not getting in too many years after that, from what I can tell. Meaning, 15, 20 years from now, the top two home run hitters of all time, which could be Alex Rodriguez and Barry Bonds, and six of the top 12 home run hitters of all time, not to mention the best pitcher, Roger Clemens, that most of us have ever seen, none of those guys is going to be in the Hall of Fame. So we have a lot of explaining to do at that point, and that's why this issue is such a difficult one to sift our way through.
Is it fair to say, Timmy, that you didn't learn anything new today, that you suspected this, and as a result, your vote's not going to change, that you kind of knew this all along, or at least had a real serious hunch about it?
Well, I surely suspected it. I think the 23% vote shows that almost every voter suspected this. Otherwise, Mark McGwire would be a Hall of Famer. I mean, look, you can argue this till the cows come home, but his numbers, to me at least, are Hall of Fame numbers. The reason he's getting 23% of the vote is people suspected that he did performance-enhancing drugs. And again, anyone with a connection to that, for a lot of voters, is never going to get in the Hall of Fame from here on out.
Do the cows ever come home, Tim?
Good point. Stupid cliche on my part. The point is well made, though, Ravi, that as Hall of Fame voters, this is the hardest thing we've ever had to do. Mm. Not even close. And they just flipped it in our... We had this tacit agreement in Major League Baseball. This is all going on. Then they just flip it in the hands of the baseball writers and said, you guys decide what to do here. People want punishment for these players. Let's keep them out of the Hall of Fame. I certainly understand that. But every one of these guys for the rest of his life is going to be going around, and they're going to say that guy's a liar and he's a cheater. He cheated the game. That's punishment indeed, on some level at least.
All right, let's bring Buster in here. Buster, as Tim just pointed out, I mean, if in fact, you know, you're looking at Bonds and McGwire and Sosa and Alex Rodriguez, if A-Rod gets up to the 700, 750, 800 mark, what does it say? I guess it feels, knowing you're sort of tied into the fabric of baseball, about the sport to know that six of your top 12 home run hitters of all time have been linked to this.
It's going to be a tremendous quandary, I think, for the Baseball Hall of Fame, because it's going to be like their jets lined up on the runway waiting to take off, and you throw Pete Rose into that mix as well. And I don't think there's any question that what's going on with McGwire is bad news for those other guys, because I think this is a Mark McGwire precedent, so to speak, for a lot of the voters. And keep in mind, all it takes to keep a player out of the Hall of Fame is 25% plus one. And I suspect, but don't know, that there's a real strong core voters, 40 to 50%, that feel much differently than Tim and I do about this entire issue. And they're never going to vote for anyone connected with this issue. And especially with guys getting locked in on not voting for McGwire year after year after year, I think that's going to continue for a very large core writers and keep out the Rodriguez's, the Bonds, the Clemens, players like that.
Do you think that this in some ways helps for those who have kind of suspected all along, I'm not going there, I know he did it, I know he did it, I know he did it, and as a result, I know a bunch of others, ha, he He now has admitted it, so I've been right not only about him, but I'm now convinced I'm right about everybody else.
I think that's part of it. I do think that he is going to get a bit of a bump. One of the common refrains we've seen from some sports writers who haven't voted for him is, well, he's not going to talk about the past. Well, I'm not going to talk about his past, so I'm not going to vote for him. I wouldn't be shocked if next year his vote total goes from the 23% into the 30 range somewhat. But I think after that, it's going to stop. I just don't think he's going to advance because of that large core voters we're talking about.
All right, Buster, Tim, we'll have more from those guys coming up in just a sec. Also ahead of us here, we'll be joined by T.J. Quinn to shed some light on what happened during that congressional testimony back in 2005. But when we return, if you have not heard Mark speak about the subject, you will. Mark McGwire, in his own words. Now back here on Baseball Tonight, Mark McGwire implied that if healthy, he would have put up the numbers without using steroids. He cited his injuries. Games missed during the notable years of using performance-enhancing drugs from 97 to 99, 22, 193 home runs in that span. So again, the ability to get healthy, get on the field, certainly allowed him to continue to do what he does really well, which was hit home runs. Earlier today, Mark McGwire spoke to the Associated Press after he released his statement.
Well, it's very emotional. It's, telling family members, friends, and coaches. It's former teammates try to get a hold of, that I'm coming clean and being honest. And, it's the first time they've ever heard me, talk about this. I hid it from everybody. So let them look at it. The man upstairs only gives you things on this earth that you can handle. So here to come clean and to fight through this so we can just move on from here. If you go back to 05 and when I met my attorneys and when we sat there and talked about things, one of my attorneys, Marty Steinberg, was a former federal prosecutor, and the advice from him and Mark Bierbauer, Marty being a federal prosecutor, gave me a couple scenarios saying that if we talked about this, well, first of all, I was definitely ready, willing, and I was ready to talk about it. But when these scenarios came up, one specifically, possible prosecution. Secondly, would be any summons to a grand jury testimonies. We worked behind the scenes with Congressman Davis and Congressman Waxman to try to get immunity. Because I wanted to talk about this. I wanted to get this off my chest. I wanted to move on, but unfortunately, immunity was not granted. And then from the advice of my attorneys, they could not advise me to go and to talk about my past. And so, and the biggest reason was is if I did that and there was a possibility of being prosecuted or summons to grand juries, I'm throwing my whole family, I'm throwing closest friends and other people that were with me, I'm putting them in something for some act that I did and that I totally regret. And so I told my attorneys that I will take the hit and I will do anything to protect my family. And so I elected to take the hit, which I've been taking the hit for 5 years. That was the worst 48 hours of my life. Go through that. But I had to listen to the advice of my attorneys. And I wish, you know, I wish 5 years back now, I wish that I did get immunity, because I would have come clean 5 years ago. And I could have moved on from it, but it didn't happen. And I'll tell you what, it was not enjoyable to sit there and to, sorry, it's pretty emotional, but it's to sit there and, you know, to repeat that I don't want to talk about the past, and then to have the family members and Don Hoot and his family, the other families back there, and every time I say, I'm not going to talk about the past, I hear moanings back there, and it was absolutely ripping my heart out. You know what? All I was worried about was protecting my family and myself, and I was willing to take the hit. You know, to me, that's more important, to take the hit, instead of the other scenario of putting my family and friends and whoever involved in something that I did. So by taking the hit and not talking about it, I look back now, I wish that I had got immunity, but I took the hit. And it's times have changed, and it's unfortunate that's the era that I played in. So wish there was drug testing back in those days, because I wouldn't be talking to you right now, I guarantee you that.
I think we really could comment on that in a moment, but first, here's what Representative Tom Davis, the former U.S. representative from Virginia, the Republican, said about McGwire. He would have been a nice head to put on somebody's mantle, so he basically took the fifth. It was very clear to everybody involved that he had taken steroids. Otherwise, he would have gotten up there and denied it, but he couldn't. He looked ridiculous to most of the public, he went on to say, but he didn't have many good options. We put him in a pretty tight spot. He was candid and honest in our interrogation of him. He said, someday I'll tell the story. Prior to actually going in front of Congress, McGwire had confided in Davis that he did use steroids. On Capitol Hill that day was our own ESPN investigative reporter, TJ Quinn. He has his own thoughts on this as well. For more on the story, our investigative reporter on ESPN, TJ Quinn, joins us. Among the things that McGwire said, what is the most sort of startling to you and your background with going all the way back to congressional hearings, the Balco investigation? What sort of struck you the most as being out of sync?
Well, the fact that he said they didn't help, that they didn't do anything to contribute to his career. He'd be the first guy who used them with that kind of that kind of length and didn't get any benefit from it. That's the one thing very few people are going to dispute who know anything about performance-enhancing drugs, is that they do work. And we also know something about the nature of the drugs that he took. I know he said he couldn't remember what they were, but 2005, 3 days before that hearing, we had a story in the New York Daily News that detailed at least one array of drugs that he got from a convicted steroid dealer, a guy from Michigan named Kurt Wenzlaff. And the list that the FBI had gotten included serious steroids, Winstrol V, Equipoise. Those are equine drugs that are given to horses. Testosterone cypionate. These are the things that serious hardcore steroid users will put in their bodies, bodybuilders, weightlifters. They're not low doses and they're not mild drugs. They would have had a profound impact on his body.
He did imply, as you just mentioned, low dosages of steroids and HGH, I believe. I believe you said once, maybe twice. Based on the things you're saying, it suggests that the truth and lies are blurred here in this interview.
Well, all I know is what players have told me, and I had players tell me years ago that Mark McGwire told them in 1998, after the season, that he had started using what then was a new drug to people in the game, human growth hormone, and that the reason he was taking it, he was stacking it with steroids, and he was telling guys that, hey, this stuff is great, While you build this huge physique, HGH will strengthen your connective tissue, your tendons, your ligaments. Medically, that's not true. But players heard that from McGwire. They believed it. And there are a number of players I've spoken to who said that they started using it because of his endorsement.
Let me ask you this, TJ. You were there on Capitol Hill. For the layman who listened to Mark and were maybe confused by some of the things he said, why was he able to go to Tom Davis, seemingly have a discussion before everything took place, talk about immunity, not be granted immunity? Why did that discussion take place at all? And why was he so fearful of disclosing the truth?
Well, there were a number of conversations beforehand. McGwire's people were very concerned that he could be exposed to possibly, I don't think they're worried so much about perjury, but worried that some prosecutor would hear him confess that he'd used it and could say, good, I'm going to nail the guy for possession when he was in my town and in any of the cities he would have traveled to with the Cardinals. But Bud Selig and baseball's lobbyists, they have very well-paid lobbyists, made a strong pitch to Tom Davis and members of that committee saying, hey, look, leave this guy alone. He's a good guy. They made what I've been told was a subtle but pretty clear offer that, hey, Bud Selig will come. You can beat up on him, but take it easy on McGwire. And you saw that during those hearings, that when Elijah Cummings and other members of that committee tried to go after McGwire, Tom Davis cut them off. And Davis himself said shortly afterward, he thought that McGwire was going to be more open about it. Now, look, the fact is, he could have been exposed to some possible prosecution, but in all my research, I've never heard of a single case of an athlete who was prosecuted for use or for possession of steroids. You're busted for trafficking or for lying to grand juries about it, but not that. And the fact was, that statute, it was a 5-year statute. It expired the next year. He's had plenty of opportunities since then to talk about it. He was approached by George Mitchell and his investigators and refused to speak to them as well.
It sounds like you have as many questions now as you did even before this interview.
Possibly more. Hope we get a chance to ask them, because there's a lot he didn't answer tonight.
What would be the first question you'd ask him?
Oh, boy. Well, if they didn't work, why'd you take them?
TJ Quinn, we appreciate you joining us here on our Baseball Tonight special.
Thanks, Ravi.
We can't ask Mark because he's obviously not here, but I'd ask you, why would McGwire say he wished that there was drug testing when he was playing?
Apparently, according to him, since it was for healing purposes only, apparently he wanted a shorter career than what he had, because it's obvious that according to him, why he used the steroids and human growth hormone once or twice was for injury reason, to put him on the field so he could perform at a high level. If he didn't, obviously he wouldn't have been able to play at a high level, would have had to quit earlier. He would have had a good career, but not a great career like he had.
Right. Drug testing then, when somebody admits that they were using it, would expose him.
Yes, it would.
All right, we'll come back on this special edition of Baseball Tonight, the day that Mark McGwire admits to using steroids for nearly a decade, including that historical 1998 Summer of Love that he and Sammy Sosa enjoyed. Back here on Baseball Tonight, the fewest career at-bats per home runs in baseball history. And Bob Costas tried to get McGwire to acknowledge that the ratio by which he hit home runs per at-bats did go up, as did Barry Bonds, but McGwire wouldn't really take the bait and make the connection between performance enhancings and those numbers. But McGwire did talk to the Associated Press after he divulged that he had used steroids for a decade, and we'll pick it up where he talks about the turning point of his career.
The toll of the season, the 162 games, and getting paid a lot of money and trying to stay up to that level. And then, again, during that time, 93 and 94, those were the years that, even though I wasn't playing, I was on the bench, and that was actually my turning point in my career as far as a hitter. I mean, that's when I started really learning how to study pitchers and study my hit, my swing, actually my swing changed from a back-legged, wall scraping home run hitter to the guy that learned how to hit a baseball,
yeah,
hit through a baseball, and my baseball was traveling, but the evolution of my swing that changed over time. There's no way a pill or an injection will give you hand eye coordination or the ability or the great mind that I've had as a baseball player.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that the work ethic that I never talked about with the media, only, you know, coaches or teammates that used to see me, you know, being the first one in, you know, working out. I was always the last one to leave. Well, I was just doing things. I took care of myself. You know, I didn't have any close friends playing baseball on the team. You know, all my friends were off. There were people that, with normal jobs. They were away from the field. And I grew up thinking, you know, and learned that the only way to prepare yourself to play these games to the best of your ability is to take care of yourself and understand that, you know, this is how you're going to get good. And the hours and hours that I put in the tee work and soft toss, and unfortunately for me, yes. Mm. And I it's something that is very, very regrettable. Mm. And, I mean, I can't emphasize enough that I truly wish there was testing. And besides that, I think what's great with what's happening in Major League Baseball today is they've cleaned up the baseball. Mm-hmm. They've have tough the tough testing and the you know, the suspensions, and mm-hmm. I think it's they've done a great job, and you have to give a lot of credit to Bud and the Players Association for coming together. You know, I asked to do that, but you know, I never heard from anybody. You know, I've done things, what I've done as far as charities and taking care of things, I've done privately, and I'll continue to do privately, and that's just mm-hmm. the way. I've always been a private person, and I love doing, I don't need to do charity work with cameras around. As far as names, I don't remember names, but, okay. You know, yes, I did injections, and but the majority of them were oral. Yeah, I talked to Tony this morning, and that was pretty emotional. But you know, he's been such a great supporter of mine, and it's you know, it's tough to tell people you really care about and love, and. Yeah, it's pretty tough. Yeah, and he's been great. He's very, very understandable, and so are my parents. And you know, the biggest thing that they've said is just they're very proud of me that I'm doing this. They all believe it's for the better, and. And then I just hope we can just move on from this and, you know, start my new career as a coach. Mm-hmm. I knew this day was going to come, and I didn't know when, but it's been a rough morning. I mean, I'm ready to take it on and tell my story, just, again, to be honest, and to hope we can just move on from this.
Mark McGwire in his own words. When we come back, we'll have Rick Sutcliffe, a man who gave up a home run to McGwire the first time he faced him. Join us on Baseball Tonight.
Back to Wines and Fires. Big Mac, swing, and a shot into the corner. It might make it. There it is. 62, folks. It just got over the left field wall in the corner. And we have a new home run champion.
Single season, passing the great Roger Maris that night for a 62nd home run. You take a look at what Mark did from 1996 through 1999. He hit more home runs than anybody else, 245. And all the other power categories, was he ranked first. 36, by the way, home runs more than the second place home run hitter during that span. That was Ken Griffey Jr. Joined now by Rick Sutcliffe. Before we went to break, we talked about McGwire's first at bat. That was May 18, 1992, against Sut. And he took you over the fence. Now, 1992 seemed to preclude at least a lot of this. However, Mark said he used this for an entire decade. When he came forward with his admission, Rick, what were your thoughts?
I really don't think any of us, Ravi, that have been around baseball the last, you know, couple of decades, were surprised by what happened. As Krucky well knows, I mean, you think back, you know, on those early Oakland teams when, you know, we first got to the big leagues, there was a lot of suspicion there. When you think about Canseco and McGwire, I mean, now we know. Now we know what happened with those two guys, and there may be more that come out before it's all said and done. But, you know, when I think about Mark McGwire, I think about going to Old Busch Stadium and watching an early batting practice with him leaning on the cage. I watched a lot of great players, Ravi, take BP in that ballpark. I never seen anybody come close to hitting the balls up there over the monuments out of the stadium like he did. I would have bought a ticket just to watch his batting practice. And I mean, even before that, there were some suspicions. But when I saw that there, I said, I don't know what's going on. But I tell you what, it's something that is changing the game of baseball.
People did suggest, though, that even at USC he was hitting prodigious home runs. And of course, in his first year, he had 49. And obviously, those Oakland teams were very big into weightlifting. Do you think that a lot of people, they may have had their suspicions, but at that point, attributed, while their increased size, to the fact that they were into the weights, while not many other organizations were?
I tell you what, Ravi, I remember watching them in spring training coming through the gates out there at old Randolph Park down there in Tucson. It looked more like the Oakland Raiders than it did the Oakland A's. I don't think there's any question that when, you know, Ravi, we go back to the seminars that we were privy to with ESPN years ago, where they brought in the doctors and the experts on mm-hmm. steroids, and I found out a lot of things that we didn't know. We knew that it was going to add some muscle to people. What I didn't know was about the recovery time. Not only for a pitcher in his arm being able to come back and long toss or throw the very next day, but, you know, hitters were able to go into the weight room day in, day out, so there was a decided advantage there. And then what blew me away was when they talked about on steroids, on HGH, a combination, how a hitter's vision, if you're a 20-20 guy, I mean, you could very easily go to 20-10. So when you put all of that together, it's kind of easy to see, Ravi, not only how steroids changed the game of baseball, it changed the record book, but it changed a lot of people's lives, like what Buster Olding was talking about earlier with Wally Joyner.
Do you have an impression, Rick, that I mean, it's almost as if every time there's an admission, and in the case of McGwire, where the suspicions are confirmed by McGwire himself, that this was a bigger problem? I mean, does your perception of the percentages of people kind of grow every time that another revelation comes out?
Ravi, I really think it's helping us to once again continue to move forward with all of this. And I there's no question that the game right now and the drug policies and everything that are in place are much better off now than they were 2 years ago, and they're going to be even better off 2 years from now. But I got a question for you. With all of this going on with McGwire, one thing that came up with me, back at the end of 2008 with Manny Ramirez, he played 53 games with the Dodgers. He hit .396. The Dodgers won the National League West by 2 games over the Arizona Diamondbacks. Now, we know that the following year in 09, at some point, Manny got suspended for something. Mm-hmm. Well, you know what happened before that? The manager of the Arizona Diamondbacks, Bob Melvin, got fired. Do you think Manny hitting almost .400 the last 53 games had anything to do with the outcome in the West? I would say, yeah, it probably had something to do with it. Do you think it had something to do with Bob Melvin and what went on in his career and his family? Manny went on to hit .500 in the division series against the Cubs when they swept those 3 games. Did that have an impact? What about the Cub fan and the lives that were affected there? I don't know if Manny Ramirez was tested the last 2 months of the season of 08. I don't know if he was tested in the... I don't know. We don't know any of that. I don't know what he tested positive for. But I know one thing. It changed a lot of people's lives. And that's why I'm anxious to see all of this stuff come out. I want everything to come out so that when the dust settles, we know exactly what happened. And Ravi, the last thing I got to tell you, I never saw a steroid throughout my whole career. I still to this day have it. I played with Ryne Sandberg. I played with Andre Dawson. I played with Cal Ripken. I played with Ozzie Smith. I don't know that stuff was ever in our clubhouse, but I know one thing. The people that admitted that were on it, I mean, the Ken Caminitis, the Consecos, it made a difference.
Given the benefit of time, perhaps, Rick, some of those other stories will change as well. We appreciate you joining us on Baseball Tonight.
Well, and I appreciate you bringing up that homer I gave to him in the first at-bat, too. That's nice of you, Ravi.
Yeah, but just think, you did retire him 4 other times, Rick. He was only 2 for 6 in his career.
That was the end of my career, buddy. That's not fair.
Well, life isn't fair, Rick. You know that. Thanks for being here.
As always, great talking to you, buddy.
All right, we'll continue our coverage of the Mark McGwire story here on Baseball Tonight. Hall of Fame? That's a question we discussed already. We'll get some final thoughts on some of the things that have been said today and tonight. Concluding a long day with a look at the most home runs in Major League Baseball history. As it stands, Barry Bonds with 762. Number two on that list, Henry Aaron. More people will probably hop on the Henry Aaron is still the number one home run hitter of all time. Babe Ruth, number three at 714. Mark McGwire sits there at number eight, tied with Alex Rodriguez, each with 583. I think Alex Rodriguez is a pretty interesting story because of where we've seen Alex go, including last year. Given health, given a healthy hip, he's going to continue to climb that. I wonder, in light of McGwire's situation, how you think McGwire will, Rodriguez is going to be judged in all this, especially later in his career.
Well,
because he came and told everybody he used it?
I think it's going to be just like Bonds, just
you
like
do.
Sosa, just
really?
Like McGwire. There's going to be an asterisk beside everything they do in the court of public opinion, and that's the media. You know, I just don't think they're ever, this era of baseball, the steroid, so-called steroid era, even if they admitted it, I think there's always going to be that doubt whether they're as good as what they really were.
Is there a distinction, and let's bring Tim Kirkchen back in on this. A lot of people, Tim, seem to want to make the distinction that Bonds and Rodriguez were for some reason Hall of Famers before they used and will be maybe after they used, and that McGwire maybe wasn't. Do you square with that distinction at all?
Well, Barry Bonds and Alex Rodriguez are better baseball players and have had better careers than Mark McGwire. To me, Mark McGwire's numbers are still Hall of Fame numbers. And my friend Dan Shaughnessy from the Boston Globe uses this analogy that if you shoot 31 on the front nine and you cheat on the back nine, you are disqualified for the round. So he's not buying this already a Hall of Famer before he cheated. If you cheat, you're out. I maintain, however, golf is a lot different than baseball. In golf, they call themselves on their own penalties, where in baseball, you throw at a guy's head for running the bases too slowly, and you go in cleats high trying to spike the guy at second base. Two completely different sports, if you ask me.
But certainly in baseball, bending the rules, pushing the rules is certainly allowed. And in golf, too, they try to do that on occasion with equipment. But you're right in the distinction that they call penalties on themselves. Let's get Buster Olney in here. Buster, sort of a final thought on what today meant to you, some of the things you heard.
Well, for Mark McGwire, it's certainly an opportunity to move forward. I do think he's going to get absolutely pounded by columnists on talk radio, by nitwits like me, I think on blogs, about his answer about how performance-enhancing drugs affected his career. But I think after those 120 hours, and maybe after the Saturday Night Live skit, at least he'll be able to move forward and pursue the job of hitting coach of the St. Louis Cardinals with Tony La Russa, his friend, protecting him in a one-newspaper town, and he can just do his job, and he can tell writers, look, I've answered your questions now.
All right, Buster Olney, Tim Kirkchen, thank you for your help all afternoon. And, of course, our coverage of this story will continue tomorrow as we do Baseball Tonight again at 3:30 Eastern time in the afternoon. So here we are, ready to go on at 3:30, and at 3:15, this news breaks, 15 minutes before. And I'm left 8 hours later to think, you know what, I'm not certain that there's anything really new today. It just seemed to confirm a lot of the suspicions. And the suspicions, I guess, now become almost convictions with regards to others. And I'm not sure that's fair.
No, it's not fair. But, you know, Mark even admitted that, you know, the suspicions, the thoughts that everyone had of him, well, now it's true. We all know what he has done. And, you know, the bottom line in this whole thing, Carl, what everyone has asked for, and I said it earlier in this show, what they asked for was, admit it. If you did it, stand up, be a man, admit you did it, and then suffer the repercussions from that. He did that. Look, because he says performance-enhancing drugs didn't help him hit home runs, again, we will disagree with that till like Tim said, the cows come home. But the bottom line is, he admitted it. Now he moves on, he becomes a hitting coach, and returns to baseball where he should be.
All right, well, the good news is the cows, in fact, are coming home as we are running out of time on this 90-minute edition of Baseball Tonight. Just a reminder to everybody that Baseball Tonight will be seen every Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday at 3:30 Eastern time. Please join us then, and hopefully the news will be back on the field with John Kruk and all else. I'm Carl Reimer.